talked about on Facebook. Once you get your area set up, they're pretty darn easy to grow. If you can provide them what they need, they're not a hard plant to grow, and they're really hardy. I have very few pest problems outside of the ones I've named, and most of it is usually if I don't see a problem crop up, it's in a new plant I just got in. The ones I've had in my greenhouse that have proven their stuff, I don't really have problems with.
So do you keep your new ones away from your...
Depends on where I'm from. Mm-hmm. If it's from Lowe's, it can be questionable.
Yeah, flower.
It just depends. If I know where I got it from, then I don't worry. So. They're hard to overwater. So, you know, you can get those day in and day out, or rains 3 days in a row. I don't really have to worry about them. They're fine. And sometimes they're in here. May and June, you don't rain for days on end. As long as you're outside, you're fine. I don't really have a lot to do in the summer, so I'm going to use a fertilizer on once a week. Enjoy the flowers.
Because so in the summer, are they out of the greenhouse?
Here's another one. So I did this. One of my heaters, I got two heaters. One of them decided to go out at night. It got down below 20. Got down to 45 in the greenhouse. It only took one night of whole damage on this plant, really warm, loving plant. But you see this kind of yellow coloration in the leaves? That's what happens when you get, I call cold damage, of course, that's not freezing, that's just letting it get down below about 50. What's happened here is the cold has stressed the plant and is uncovering some kind of underlying problem is what you've done. So this case, this is probably a nutrient deficiency. Because it's not, it doesn't have a pattern. If it was a virus, you normally have a pattern. Viruses have almost a mosaic pattern, so you'll have like little circles, almost like a regular pattern in the leaf. But anyway, what you do, the stress of the cold is, you know, it now starts showing symptoms.
But will that repair if you warm it up?
Well, no. These leaves are goners, unfortunately. This plant now looks like a palm tree. I've done this past winter. The plant's been out all summer and slowly lost these leaves. Didn't kill the plant. Plant's fine. It's blooming great all summer. It's just ugly. But the nutrient deficiency really comes from this. Vandas mostly come from Thailand. That's where they breed them. That's where they miracle them. And then they ship them over here once they're blooming size. They tend to have a severe micronutrient deficiency, which is basically calcium and magnesium. You don't notice it because they don't have the cold over there. You get them over here, you expose them to cold, then you start seeing them crop up. So, all right, so now I'm gonna say how I grow them. Most of that's all information I've got from the South Florida growers. So here's some of the specific things I do. So I use wire hangers. I don't use any media. I mean, this is kind of my preferred way of growing them. It's easy, it's cheap, you don't have to buy pots. I get these little rolls of wire from Lowe's, Home Depot, about $10 a roll for the thicker wire is like 50 foot for 10 bucks. You can get the smaller gauge wire, you can get 100 feet for like 10 bucks. Use galvanized wire. If you want to do that, do not use copper. Copper is toxic. You don't really want to use anything that rusts either. Galvanized is cheap. Stainless steel is fine, but it's expensive. So. Occasionally, I'll have some in a clay pot or a basket. That's usually because they came that way and can't get them out without tearing the roots. I don't use any media in my pots or baskets for the Vandas, so they're all wrong without media. Occasionally, I'll use corkers or flip to mount some of my miniatures, but some of my stuff that stays small like this. Anyway. As far as water and fertilizer, right now, I'm watering twice a day because it's been, you know, we haven't had rain in like 3 weeks now. It's really, really dry, so I just had to set my timer. I set my timer to bump it up twice a day. I water for 20 minutes. I got some low flow nozzles. They're just the little nozzles you can buy. You go to Home Depot or Lowe's. They're made for the little drip systems. they have, you don't want the ones that just drip, but they have some little low flow nozzles that kind of spray it out. It's almost like a little sprinkle. I say I have a timer, it sets for 20 minutes. Of course, I automate mine because I don't get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I actually discovered the 4 o'clock in the morning thing by accident because I don't have enough water pressure to water my plants and take a shower. And I get up at 5 o'clock to take a shower. So I say, I do water for 20 minutes, but I've got 3 water lines. So I have to run each one for 20 minutes, so it takes a full hour to water everything. Thankfully, my water's cheap. So that's the reason for 4 o'clock in the morning. I actually discovered by accident that it worked better than turning on at 6 o'clock in the morning.
So what time do you water in the afternoon?
Right now, I've got it coming on at 5:30. It's a balance between watering them so that they mostly dry before dark and waiting for the wind to die down. So I water overhead, so if it's windy, I might as well not water because it's going everywhere but on the plants. Any of your lines run in the sun, my lines are black. I wouldn't water at 2 o'clock, but I'm probably going to scald the plants because the water is very hot. You either have to dump the water out, which I've done. I dump it out in an extra quart, let it run for a minute, it clears out the lines, gets all the hot water out from where it's been set in the sun, and then run the regular water through it. Now winter, you got the opposite problem. You don't like to be wet and cool, so it means they don't like cold water. Our groundwater, the water comes out of the faucet in the wintertime, it's too cold. So you really want to use water, I put 70 degrees is kind of the minimum. Water between 70 and 80 degrees is about right. Since I started doing this, it's made a tremendous difference in how often my plants bloom.
How do you get your cold water up to 70 to water your orchids?
Well, I can't automate mine during the winter because I don't have a hot water heater in my greenhouse. Thankfully, my greenhouse is close enough to my kitchen that I can run a hose through the kitchen window and put it in the faucet sink.
Okay.
Which is why they also get watered about every other day during the wintertime. So I've got it set on the timer once I turn it on, but I have to turn it on, you have to run it through the hose, you got to heat the hose up, the hose has been sitting outside, it's cold. And then once everything's warm, then then it'll run through the cycle with all 3 hoses.
So if we do dip them to water, you still let it sit in there for 20 minutes?
You can still, yeah, you can soak them for 20 minutes.
And then go back and do it again for 20 minutes?
No.
Okay.
If you're soaking them, this was more of if you're going to water them like with a water hose, just spray it until it drips, and then go back and spray it again 20 minutes later. Because it's given, what it's done is that first time you spray it, it's soaked up everything you can soak up.
Mm-hmm.
When you spray it again, it will soak up some more.
Okay.
That's what these roots act like a sponge.
Does it matter the size? So if you have like the little smaller ones, can you do it for less time?
Well, some of these have thinner roots, but that's more of a different kind. But like this one, I mean, its roots are just as thick as the big ones.
So 20 minutes is good.
Yeah, 20 minutes is about right. So fertilizer, which I'm cutting you off a little bit, this actually, I've gotten some new information recently, this past weekend recently, so I haven't fixed my slide. So I've used this for years, and it works great. There's no reason not to use it that I've found so far. I've not experimented enough with anything new to know if I like it better. But this Peters XL CalMag, this is kind of what all the South Florida growers use. I used it for years. It's 15, 5, 15. The 5 and 2 numbers are the percentages of calcium and magnesium. You pretty much want to supplement Vandas with calcium and magnesium. I have recently switched this K-Lite. I actually switched going in the summer, but I've worked so much this summer, I've not been consistent enough with my fertilizing to make any difference. But really what you're doing here, so if you go back to the fertilizers, for years it was 3 numbers were all the same ratio NPK. Then they discovered you drop the middle number, you get better growth, better blooming. So that was the next evolution of it, and that's what this Peters has done, it dropped that middle number down below the other two. Now, with your K-Lite, you're dropping the potassium down, which is the third number. So recently I've swapped some emails with Rick. Yep. He has actually uncovered some information that the Vandas really like citric acid. So way to get citric acid in them is to add lemon juice to your fertilizer. Does two things. If you use a tap water is normally pH neutral, so it's got a pH of 7 degrees. Got a pH of 7. Plants really absorb nutrients best with a pH around 5.6 to 5.8, which happens to just be the pH of rainwater. So that's the reason it is pretty good to mix your fertilizer with rainwater, because you get a better pH. Lemon juice works in that if you use tap water, you can use lemon juice to actually drop the pH. So you can get the best of both worlds. But I guess Rick has discovered that, reading a paper, that Vandas specifically have an organism that lives in their roots in the wild that produces citric acid. So having the lemon juice has an additional benefit for them. But I haven't experimented with any of that yet, so I am going to. Now, I've lowered this down to 1 teaspoon per gallon. I've read a lot of South Florida growers say use 1 tablespoon to 2 tablespoons per gallon. I've used it. I've not burned the roots. I'm not sure it does anything, but waste fertilizer, and fertilizer is not cheap. So, especially, I use a lot of it. So I've cut back to this. I've really not noticed a difference. I do cut my fertilizer in the cooler months because they're not growing as much. It's a lot colder, even in the greenhouse, it's crafty. They're not growing as good. Now, I put on none if they go dormant. I used to have a problem in January and February with all my Vandas going completely dormant. I mean, they'd quit blooming. I mean, there'd be no blooms in the whole greenhouse, no root growing tips, nothing. But I got some draft issues. I had some cold air coming in some places. I got that thin 55. Sometimes I'll wait to 50. If the forecast below 50 where I'm at, it usually means it's going to be down to 55. So that's usually October. They're still out right now. It's nice if the first time we've been out in the 50s, it's just going to be 57. So they'll be out. Just want to use the bigger chunks of bark and the bigger chunks of charcoal, and it would be okay.
And just make sure it just dries out really well before you water it again.
And keep the media like fresh. Don't go too long. You know, don't let the media break down. And you see how small it stays? There's another good thing about those is those don't have to have as much light as I'm giving them. They'll bloom in high Cattleya light. So you can put those on a windowsill and do pretty. That's a seed pod. Well, I just haven't gotten around to cutting it off because the hummingbirds pollinated it for me. So I don't know what pollen they used. So it's not worth waiting 5 years to see what might come out of it.
What do you mean? You would just leave it on there?
If you wanted to keep the seeds, you would leave it on there. But it's growing orchids from seeds is, you have to put them in a sterile flask. You can't just plant them. So it's a 5-year investment and I don't know what that is.
Why is that? I mean, why can they take care of themselves in the wild and we can't grow their seeds?
It has to do with the fungus. Okay, so in the wild, that seed pod's got millions of seeds in it.
Right.
And you might get a handful that actually germinate. Mm-hmm. So, and there's also, basically they have a, I guess it's fungal, fungus, that lives in the roots that basically helps with the germination process. But it's kind of a, they release a lot of these seeds hoping that just a few actually germinate and make plants. Because it's kind of, the seed's like dust. It's going to fly all through the trees and it's got to land in just the perfect right spot that's got the right fungus and the right nutrients for it to grow. This is a falcata hybrid. This one's been getting way too much sunlight, which is why it's kind of got purple leaves. It can get a lot less light than it's been getting. But another one that their window in the wintertime. It's, if you got, they need the light, but if you put them too close to the window to get the light, then you got cold air coming off the window. So these don't tolerate that better.
Stacy, what was that first picture? I'm sorry. If you could go back one. What was your first picture on the left?
This one?
Yeah.
Oh, actually, it's not that one. This is a Vanda crossed with falcata. So it's a, I can get you the name for it.
Okay. That's cool.
I have to look it up. The Vanda's flowers. The flowers actually stay on the spike pretty good long while. They'll stay on there 46 weeks and then they'll, but they may flower again. I've got one I had at the show. It's been in flower since February. It makes a spike, has flowers, and while those flowers are in bloom, it makes the next spike. By the time the flowers fall off, it goes down. It's had flowers on it since then. It's one of the little yellow ones. One of the ones that's been around is pretty much has a spike on it pretty often.
Alright, there's no hanger to that one. I think I got two. You know, I've got them little cute little special, the little, look at that. They appear to grow pretty dang good. I think they're crosses.
That's not so much true with
the
falcon. Unless they're potted. As long as they're out like this, you pretty much can't overwater it.
What they look like, the bloom definitely look like.
That green one that you just saw?
It's a palm tree. Is to get the humidity up, keep it watered, hopefully it'll sprout roots at the top, and you can top it. And by topping it, I mean just cut it. And then,
Pansy just told me that Birmingham water is pretty high with a pH of 7.8.
Bring it in my soul.
Real quick, what's this?
These are the roots.
This is roots?
No, this is the leaves. These are the roots.
What's the name of the plant?
It's one of those I can't pronounce.